Good morning, students. This is my revision lecture for chapter number 2, Lost Spring, written by Annie's Jung for class 12th subject English. Children, this chapter was published in the first week of April, and today we will recall all the main points of this chapter for your better understanding. Then you will be given a revision assignment and at the end of this lecture, and that will be followed by a test on Ed Quark site. In this chapter, I'll let you know the symbolic meaning of lost spring that was described there also. As we all know, spring is the season associated with optimism and hope. It also works as a metaphor for the childhood stage of our life. Right from the time we are born until late childhood, every child hopes for new beginnings and a bright future. The phase of childhood is all about innocency, energy, and tremendous inclination towards outdoor activities along with a lot of fun and play. And no one wants this play time to be limited. Accordingly, the authoress Annie's Jung says that spring is the best season of a year. Similarly, childhood is the best stage of someone's life who wants to live it enjoyfully. And it describes the stories of a stolen childhood. This chapter introduces perpetual state of poverty, and it talks about the national shame of children being forced to live a life of poverty and exploitation. This chapter describes that this child labor must be abolished for the better future of our country. The story Lost Spring deals with the deplorable condition of poor children who get forced to miss the simple joyful moments of childhood because of their socio-economic conditions. These children are not given the opportunity of schooling and are compelled to start working early in their life. This story puts up a message to end to child exploitation and to let all children enjoy their days of the spring and joy. In the first account of Lost Spring, the author Annie's Jung talks about the boy named Sahib. And the account begins with the line, "Sometimes I find a rupee in the garbage." Here I is Sahib. And the meaning of garbage is given by the authoress for children and elders in different manner. It seems that for children, garbage has a meaning different from what it means to their parents. For the children, it is wrapped in wonder, and for the elders, it is a means of survival. The main protagonist of the account one is Sahib, who lived in Dhaka, Bangladesh, but he migrated to Simapuri in Delhi, and the reason of his migration was the natural calamity. His house was swept away due to a storm, so these people like Sahib were forced to move to the big city where they thought would get more and more money. Then the authoress Annie's Jung talks about the irony in Sahib's name. Sahib's full name is Sahib-e-Alam. Sahib-e-Alam means Lord of Universe, and she finds the irony in his name that the Lord of Universe is picking rag onto the land. Therefore, the meaning of his name directly contrasts with what he is in reality. In reality, he is a rag picker, and his name means Lord of Universe. So there is an irony that is appearing in his name. The author Annie's Jung asks Sahib the reason for not wearing chappals, or she wants his explanation on being barefoot. In return, she receives the answer that it is a custom or a tradition to be barefoot, as Sahib has to attend the army of barefooted rag pickers, so he has to follow the custom of remaining barefoot. This answer of Sahib surprises the authoress, and she feels as if it is an excuse to explain away a perpetual state of poverty that the people have been living. Now, we will talk about Saheb's family's living condition. Saheb lives on the periphery of Delhi, that is Simapuri, and more than 10,000 rag pickers live there in the structures of mud with roofs of tin and tarpaulin. They are devoid of sewage, drainage or running water. The people are living there though they do not have any identity card with them, and they are living without permissions, but they are living with ration cards and get their names registered on voters list, which enables them to buy grains. The people have been living in transit homes. The people have temporary homes and they shift from one place to another place because the people have been living miserably there. When they find the food survival is not possible at one place, they shift to some other place. This shows that how miserably they have been living, and their living standard is really pathetic. Finally, Annie's Jung talks about the disappointment of Saheb while working in the tea stall. There she finds Saheb carrying a steel canister that he finds heavier than the plastic bag he used to carry while he was on his rag picking round. He works at the tea stall though he is paid Rs. 800 per month and all his meals a day, but he is still unhappy. The reason behind it is he finds this job tougher than picking the rags on roads. Why? Because he is no longer his own master. Here at the tea stall, he has to work under a boss. There in rag picking profession, he was the master of his job. And he had lost that, therefore this feeling makes him unhappy, and the authoress also finds him unhappy working at the tea stall. This is the completion of account 1 of Lost Spring, in which the author Annie's Jung has described the life of Saheb and his living conditions, which are miserable. Similarly, there are many other children like Saheb, those who have been living their life like Saheb, and their living standard is very, very poor. In the age of going to school, they are picking rags for their survival on the roads. Children, let's proceed to the second account of Lost Spring, that begins with "I want to drive a car." Here I is the main protagonist of this second account, named Mukesh. First of all, Annie's Jung describes the living standard of Firozabad, and there he lives in Firozabad, which is famous for its bangles. Every other family in Firozabad is working at bangle industry, and the people are sitting in front of glass blowing industry. They have spent generations working around furnaces making bangles for all the women in the land, it seems. And then the authoress talks about the dream of Mukesh. Though Mukesh has been working like every other person in Firozabad in that bangle industry, but he has a different dream about his life, about his future. Mukesh's dream is to drive a car. He actually wants to learn how to drive a car. He wants to be a motor mechanic as well. Now we will speak about Mukesh's living conditions. Mukesh's family is one of the families living in Firozabad, and the people have been living in the stinking lanes which are choked with garbage, past homes that remain hovels with crumbling walls, wobbly doors, no windows, crowded with families of humans and animals coexisting in a primeval state. Then the author finds that they are living in their half-built shacks with thatched roof, and there is nothing for their survival or their economic standard, but the people have a firewood stove over which sits a large vessel of sizzling spinach leaves, and on the ground in large aluminium platters they are keeping the chopped vegetables. Now the author talks about the hazards of working at that bangle industry. She finds the people are sitting around the furnaces and welding glasses. There is lack of air and light in those dingy cells where they have been sitting since morning till night, and they are just lost in making bangles. The people are spending their day and night in those dingy cells without air and light. Therefore, their eyes get adjusted more to dark than to light. Due to this reason, they are losing the brightness of their eyes at a very young age. She finds that more than 20,000 people work there together in front of hot furnaces. And not only one or two, but many of them are losing the brightness of their eyes at a very young age. Still, the people are happy to work at that bangle industry, and they are following, and even the children are following the custom of working at bangle industry of their parents uncomplainingly, unquestionably. Now, the author talks about the reason for such people for not organizing themselves into a cooperative. The people have fear of police. There is a lack of leadership quality among the people living there. And children are also following their fathers blindly. The authoress tells that the people say, if they are ones who would be getting organized or united, then they would be hauled up by the police. They would be beaten up and dragged to jail for doing something illegal unnecessarily, because there is a lack of leader among them. Then the poetess talks about the explanation of two distinct worlds that she notices in Firozabad. She talks about the first world, that is of the people who are caught in the web of poverty. They are burdened by the stigma of caste in which they are born. The people like Mukesh and his family, those who are caught in the web of poverty, they have not raised their living standard for years and years, and they have accepted it as if it is their destiny. And the second account she notices is about the people, those who are renowned class people, like the sahukars, the middlemen, the policemen, the keepers of law, the bureaucrats and the politicians. Together they have imposed the baggage on the child that he cannot put down before he is aware that he accepted as naturally as his father. At the end of this account number 2, the authoress Anise Jung talks about Mukesh's attitude towards his situation. She finds Mukesh is quite different from others in his community. When she senses a flash of it in Mukesh, she gets cheered. She finds Mukesh wants to be a motor mechanic. Mukesh lives a dream in his eyes. For fulfilling his dream, he is ready to go to a garage which is miles away from his residence, and he is ready to go by walking there. He says the garage is long way from his home, but he is ready to walk in order to fulfill his dream. So this makes the author very happy that this boy is quite different from all the others living in Firozabad. He is content to dream of cars that he sees daily hurtling down the streets of his town, but he never dares to fly an aeroplane that he rarely sees flying in the skies of Firozabad. This is all about the account that she talks about Mukesh, his living standard, his condition, the people like Mukesh working at bangle industry, losing the brightness of their eyes at very early age, and still they are happy, and even the fathers and the grandfathers force their children to follow the tradition of working at bangle industry, and the people do not support their children to think beyond and go away from this Firozabad to make their future bright. Now let's proceed to revision assignment. Beta, this assignment I have prepared on the basis of the chapter. Some additional questions have been added there, and this chapter was explained in different lectures before, and now I have given you the recapitulation of the entire chapter, both accounts again, and on the basis of your understanding the chapter, you are supposed to answer these questions which are given on the screen. They'll be uploaded definitely on the site as well. And this will proceed to test after you receive my next revision lecture of deep water. I shall conduct a combined test of lost spring and deep water. Prepare hard. All the best. Have a nice day.